So there's so many innovative things that they've got in the Wolfram language. And the next day, Stephen started demonstrating, and this is like fantasy stuff. We were just in the cafe, and Stephen's demonstrating the Wolfram language, demonstrating its new capabilities around neural networks, what you can do with Wolfram Alpha in terms of bringing in data sets to do analysis and this sort of thing. And I'm like, Stephen, you know, we've got this meeting coming up, DALI, you know, we'd love to see some of this stuff here, because I just don't think in this community we're so aware of what's in there. And he said, oh, you know, I've got these guys, they're South African based, Sebastian's one of them who did the implementation of that, and I thought it would be a great sort of choice for symposium. Whether you use Wolfram language or not, I think you'll see some of the ways that they're doing things. Sebastian's just going to do a sort of live demonstration of what they can sort of do around neural networks and bringing in data sets. So I think Sebastian's happy for you to sort of interrupt and ask him if he could do certain things that you think you should be able to do, and see if he can do them live. Sebastian, don't ask him to do an F divergence measure GAN to generate. It's not to sort of test the limits of what he can do. It's to sort of try and show the functionality. So I think there'll be some obvious things like model repurposing and things like that that I think Sebastian will be able to do. So over to Sebastian.
Cool. Thanks so much for inviting me to this conference. Yeah, so about myself, I was one of the implementers of the neural network framework for Mathematica, or the Wolfram language. Before that, I was in physics. So that is how I got into using Mathematica. Like, quite a large proportion of physicists use Mathematica. And I'll show a little bit now why. Okay, so I guess I want to first just give a quick feeling, or give people a feeling for what exactly Mathematica is about. And Mathematica and Wolfram language, so Wolfram language is now the formal, it's the language specification, and Mathematica is like, is the software that implements it. Okay, so the sort of, breakdown of the talk will be that I first want to just show a little bit about what Mathematica is and do some live demos. And then also I want to show what data science looks like in Mathematica and deep learning, which is my own baby. Okay. So, Mathematica, quick tour. So, what is the deal with Mathematica? So, one thing is that the documentation is interesting. So, this is the documentation, and this gives you some idea of what sort of fields of things there are in the system. So, for example, data analysis manipulation, there's things like machine learning, statistical data analysis, all kinds of things, data transformation. And each of these things has extra sections. And what's nice about this is that you can click on any of these. So for example, if you want to learn how to classify data, you see obviously the usages. But immediately inside the documentation, you can play around with the actual examples. So all of this is, you can just modify the doc examples and just run them inside the documentation. So as you can see, Mathematica, this is, for those of you who know Jupyter Notebook, that idea sort of came from here. So Mathematica is mostly notebook-based. So all the documentation, most of the work that you do is based on notebooks. It obviously has a scripting version as well, if you wanted to run scripts. Okay, so this is, the idea of Mathematica is that we work on every single platform. So we work on from Windows to Raspberry Pi. So we basically, there's no build issues that you've got, nothing. Everything is just in the system, it works. And we obviously, as a company, we can deal with all those sort of build issues, and you just have a simple, simple experience. Okay, so that's roughly, where did my window go? Okay. So also the other thing that's worthwhile to mention is that Mathematica, large chunks of Mathematica are actually written in Mathematica. The other parts are C++ or CUDA, whatever else you need. And just a quick sort of thing about how you do things. Mostly it's designed to be a functional language. So all the sort of functional constructs like map or fold or nest, all these sorts of things, that is sort of the recommended style for this language. But of course it has all the sort of imperative trappings. Table is just a simple do loop where you append things into the center list. Or one concept that is not that popular yet in other languages are rules. So in Mathematica, rules are a first-class citizen, or patterns. So in this case, there's a function, you give it a pattern, which says just, in this case, x underscore just means anything, and it will replace that with that thing squared. So, and I'll show you now why. Yeah, we'll see some interesting examples of these patterns. Okay, so it's designed to be a completely comprehensive programming language, as well as being having a massive standard library. And the standard library is a bit different from Python and whatnot, in that the standard library is really built into the actual language. So it's not, they're not external libraries, they've been integrated extremely carefully into the language itself. So they're part of the language specification. So from neural networks to doing calculus to doing anything like that, everything is, these are language specifications. Obviously there's other packages you can get as well if you really wanted to, but almost everything is just purely built into the language. Okay, so maybe I'll go through this very quickly. This is for people that are interested in sort of language design. In Mathematica, one of the differences between other languages is that for most languages, execution means running a statement or function that calls other functions. Mathematica and execution means taking that expression and applying rewrite rules until it stops changing. So everything is an expression in Mathematica. And there's either atomic pieces of the expression, for example, like integers or strings or real numbers, and then there's compound expressions, like associations, which are basically Python dictionaries, or other kinds of things. And all these sorts of expressions, they have, if it's a compound expression, there's a head, you can ask what that is, or make your own compound expression, in this case foo, and all of these have parts as well. So you can ask for the part of any sort of compound expression, whether it's foo bar. Okay, and for associations, similar sort of thing. Okay, then expressions can be arbitrarily nested. So for example, if we have an expression like this, we can always ask to have the actual expression tree. So it's very easy to analyze Wolfram language code because you can always construct this expression tree and you can do computations on the expression tree. So for example, so you can use this for many different sort of things. So for example, like if you have an expression, which in this case is a graphics object, and things like graphics objects or images, all of these are just normal expressions in Mathematica. And you can have lists of them, you can, they're first class citizens of the language. So you can, again, you can visualize like what this graphics form looks like. And there's a whole bunch of random things. Okay, and then the last sort of thing, and this is almost done, this part of the thing, is that functions are merely rules that rewrite certain expressions to others. So in this case, function is always a pattern as well. So you could say this is an integer, for example. This would match an expression with head integer, and then it would apply this transformation to it. Okay, I'll just put this back. So X here is a pattern, and you can write extremely complicated patterns here. And you can have, what's interesting about the patterns then is that you can have very complicated dispatch for functions, because you can match the input to some pattern, and then you can do some execution path for that. And we can also always use trace and see what exactly a function is doing. And if no more rules can be applied, then it stops the evaluation. So you can see it starts with this, it tries to apply a rule, it puts it into this form, and then it does this transformation, and now it knows that this is an atomic type and it can't do any more transformations. So that's sort of how the language actually works underneath.
So this X can be anything, but It has to be a number, probably, right? There won't be an expression.
So in this case, over here, well, in this case, I've defined it to be to work for anything. But obviously types like images, if they don't have an operation squared defined on it.
Yeah, so you have to define that separately?
Yes, you'd have to define that separately if you wanted to.
Mm-hmm. But that means you don't get a type error. It simply doesn't simplify further, right? If you say foo of bar, mm-hmm. you get bar squared, right?
If you say foo of bar.
Yeah.
Yeah?
F of
bar. Oh, F of bar, sorry. Okay.
Sorry, F, yeah.
Yeah. So this is so that's as far as it can go. String squared. But what you can do is you can, so for particular types, like for string, or if you define your own type, you can obviously put, you can tell it what squared means for that. That's very easy. Okay, and then down values are the things that you can see on a function, what sort of patterns are attached to this this rule. So these functions are basically rules, and they have pattern transformations that take some input, and it goes to some pattern output. Okay, I can maybe just quickly show an example of where this is useful. So we have a graphics object, and one thing we might want to do is we want to say replace all the disks in this expression G with a similar rectangles. So we can now, because there were these disks inside here, we can try and match these disks, and this symbol here is actually, let me just replace. It's just for replace all. Oh, oops. G disk. Wait, what was that? Okay, well, this is even for now. So bam, you've now gotten with this pattern expression. So this symbol here is just that it means replacement. So it says it tries to match this guy inside the expression somewhere. So wherever it happens inside the expression, and G is this expression, which was this graphics object, we can try and replace that with a rectangle instead of a disk. Okay. So that's basically enough for this. So one of the major pieces, and which is also useful for machine learning that I found for sometimes doing research, is the symbolic algebra and calculus. So this is something that, although there's some open source packages that try and do this, they're still very, very far away from what Mathematica can do. So it's basically, I don't know, it's almost universally used amongst physicists and mathematicians to do symbolic calculations. So as in a random example of this, let's say you've got cross entropy loss, we can say, let's have symbolic variables, ins and targets, and we can also write this function, and we can say, this is what this actual function looks like symbolically, and this is just for three inputs. You can do this for arbitrary, you don't need to specify components if you don't need to, but in this case, I'm specifying components. So here's a symbolic expression, and I can quickly ask things like, what is the Jacobian of this thing? And any sort of mathematical expression, there's a lot of functions that can try and simplify your expression. So this gradient term, for example, let's actually just put this here, grads. So it'll try and find a simpler version of that, which it thinks is this versus that. Or we can get the Hessian or any other higher order derivatives that we want. Okay, in this case, obviously, it's very big. And obviously, all the sorts of things like symbolic limits, oopsie. So it defined f already, so that's why it's complaining. This g is the, yeah. Sorry, yeah, so what happens also if you use the same symbol names. Okay, so for example this, you can say, what is the limit of f of x over g of x as x goes to 0? And it'll do this analytically. So this is not a numerical approximation. There is, I think, n limits, or there's a numerical version of this as well. But often you want to have exact non-numerical versions. Power series, obviously this is supported. And obviously integration. And what's interesting with integration, so these things, there's been around 30 years of work on these, and they support extremely flexible specs from, obviously in this case, we have symbolic bounds, so infinity to minus infinity, but you can give extremely general regions to integrate over, any sort of assumptions that are on, like, you know, if you have C times that, in this case, it'll be a conditional expression because you don't know, you know, it only converges if real part is bigger than something else. But I could obviously put assumptions on the C. Maybe I know that this is greater than zero already, et cetera, et cetera. So this is just scratching the surface. It's an extremely, extremely flexible system for doing any sort of symbolic mathematics. Okay, one last one. I think Tali wanted me to show this one. So, for example, if you have a differential equation, you define the function, and then you can also define regions for integration, for many functions in the system. You can define symbolic regions. And you can, there's a whole bunch of functions that work on it, like area, for example. In this case, yeah, there's just a union of two disks. And then you could integrate that. You could, in this case, get the area, which is not trivial at all. Or you can solve the differential equation, and you get some interpolating function that is a numerical solution for this. And you can then plot it as well. And yeah, we have nice 3D plotting capabilities. Okay, so I think that's enough of the base language. It's a very useful language to have for all of these random sort of things that are very nicely polished. When you need to use calculus, it's just there. Okay, so machine learning. So this is more my domain. So our sort of philosophy is that we want to have a few different sort of options for people. One of them is we want to have completely automated machine learning. And this has been one of our major sort of research areas. So classify and predict are two examples of these, and I'll show them now. We also want maximum performance. So some people really just want, yeah, they want to be able to train on multiple GPUs, and they just they need massive performance. We also make it very easy to deploy things as cloud APIs. And the last sort of piece is that we have huge amounts of built-in knowledge. And this built-in knowledge is actually interesting because it sort of relates to the automation thing as well, and I'll get to that. Okay, so just a quick example of like how this looks like. For classify, you can give it all sorts of different data, like these are just images, so you can give it a list of, what happened there? So you can give it a list of images, you can have missing values if you want to, et cetera, et cetera. And this is, yeah, just run it. And it will decide what the best method is to use, and it will, yeah, it will create a classify function. And this thing can immediately be used to classify new digits. You can also get like top probabilities if you want to get what the actual probabilities were for this. And also, our framework is completely probabilistic. So even things like random forests to anything else, everything has to be made probabilistic. Okay, so that's how simple it is to use, and it's. You can obviously get information about what exactly it was doing. So in this case, it chose to use logistic regression, the L1, L2 regularization coefficients, etc. And you can obviously specify things like what method to use, and you can give sub-options if you really want to. And in this case, yeah, it's chosen to use these parameters for this SVM. Okay, and also we want to make it very easy to like get performance estimates, so you give a test set, and you can ask them what the accuracy is, or in this case it's 0.9, which is 90%, or get the confusion matrix plot. So basically you just want to make it as simple as possible. So one question is, how is this sort of thing built, or how do you actually automate machine learning to this extent? So this is sort of a very ongoing piece of work. But yes, the main pieces are feature extraction. So one thing we've realized is that to automate machine learning, a lot of people come with small data sets. So if they're doing, for example, like we can do classification for words, or they come with images or any kinds of things like this, the more inbuilt knowledge that your system has, the more automatable you can make things, or the better the performance can be of an automatic method. Because we can try different feature extractors and see whether those improve performance. And we can make use of, yeah, some feature extractors that we've trained for the purpose. If we can't find good features, so like, yeah, like it's some, like a CAT scan maybe is not going to work well with something trained on ImageNet, then yeah, we extract the features as pixels and we do dimensionality reduction on them. So you can also, with feature extraction, we also want to support things where there's mixed things. So there's images in this case, and there's also like text. So this works perfectly fine as well. So yeah, key to this whole thing then is like, if you can't find good feature representations, you often have to reduce the dimension, because like pixels are just too high dimension to work nicely with random forest and other things. So in this case, yeah, you want to try out some dimensionality reduction and see that the performance doesn't suffer. And PCA, is we found, is pretty good for this. And then there's other pieces, for example, like missing value imputation. And then the main thing, obviously, is the hyperparameter search. And this has major, major impacts on performance. So, and this is also tricky, because people that want to use classify and predict, they don't want to wait forever. So one has to be very careful with time budgets. So time is something that is one of the resources, that we see as very important. So we have different performance goals that have different behaviors for different times. But we basically say, this is a reasonable time for this data set, and we need to partition our search in such a way that that we make best use of that time. So this means sometimes like leaning more towards certain methods than other ones. It also means trying out subsets of data for different methods first. So you try a small sets of data, and then you sort of infer from that what the performance will be like on larger data sets. So you can set how important it is to get quality, and then it will take a lot more time. Okay, and then the other key to automation is speed. So you can always trade speed for performance with automated machine learning. Because yeah, if your method is 10 times faster, you can do 10 times more search. So we obviously, yeah, we're working on getting the fastest possible libraries for every single platform. So like Intel's data analytics acceleration library, this has implementations for support vector machine for a whole bunch of things, but it only works on x86 processors. So then you obviously have to have fallback implementations that are fast on ARM as well. So this has been sort of a key thing for the last few months, that we've been trying to ramp up the speed of this thing. Okay, and then the other important thing with machine learning is that people want to use it, and they need to be able to use it somehow. So the sort of ways that people want to use it, one of them is that they want to embed it in some device, and they want it to run natively on that device. And the other sort of major way is that they want to be able to deploy something to the cloud. So here's a simple example of this. So there's a classifier called Notable Person Classifier. This just classifies people as, yeah, into famous people. And we just define this function, and then we can deploy the function immediately. And this is true for all the system functions in Mathematica. And we can just, you know, have a title, description, et cetera, et cetera. So if I run that, it wasn't logged in. Because the problem with that is that everyone now knows who has the YouTube video what length my password is. Okay, so immediately you can click on this link, and bam, here's your web page with a title, and it has, in this case, I told it that it should be an image, so I can say try Barack Obama and submit it. Oopsie, there you go. Yeah, so it identified it correctly. So it's extremely trivial to make little web pages, for example, with this. But often you don't want the web page, you just want an API function. So I mean, here's a simple example of this. You say x, which is an integer, and you want to apply the function. So this just means this is some argument, you're squaring it, and this just means the function is ending. So it's as simple as that. Cloud deployed. You've got it, and then you can call this from, I think, So yeah, I think it just uses a REST API. So what is it? Is it like question mark x is equal to 2? There you go, 4. So this can be called now from any other service. And what we also do is, just as a courtesy, we can also, you can tell what language you want to use this API from. So from Java, from Python, whatever else you want to do. And you can run this, and you get a piece of Java code that calls this, the API correctly. So, or Python. Python is much shorter, because I think it uses, URL and code. Okay, so yeah, so one sort of major plank of this whole thing is that it should be very, very easy to deploy. Then a major thing, which is this built-in knowledge. And there's sort of three sources of built-in knowledge that are difficult to get, but they add massive value to users. So one is data, then computational components like pre-trained networks, and then API-ready functions. So things like, what is the recognizing images or classifying if a language, what programming languages, etc. So the first one is the resource system. So what we have here is that we first of all have a website where we have all of the resources. Hold on, let's put this down. It's weird. It's not resizing. Okay. So this is a publicly available website. It has huge amounts of data from all kinds of areas. You can click on one. Let's say geotag public tweets. And it always has usage examples. And you can always copy this, and this is how you use it within Wolfram language. And yeah, it has some visualizations, et cetera, et cetera. So this collection we're building is meant to be extremely extensive. It has a lot of, it should have in the long run a lot of machine learning data as well. At the moment, it doesn't have that much. So I guess an example of this would be, let's say, like MNIST. The way to get it is this thing called a resource object. And this thing can be queried. So it has a whole bunch of properties like, categories or keywords. Also like obviously the citation for where we got it from. And you can obviously get the data very easily, the resource data. Okay, well, it didn't print it. So this will be, and there's obviously you can get the test and the training set separately if you want. Okay, so basically, so this is one of the things that we want to get as much data that we've curated into, and make it as easy as possible to get from the system. And then the second piece is like API-ready functions. So things like a sentiment classifier, or image identify, which identifies any sort of image into, this should display, the display is not working properly. Okay, well this should be like a nice box. In this case is a drafting table. So what we're doing now is we're building out huge amounts of these. So there's something like 40 to 50 different functions, from like image colorization to machine translation to all kinds of things that we want to have exposed at this sort of level, and that we want to build with our tools. And the other advantage that I should maybe mention for this is that as soon as you have this, like image identify, you can easily get the network as well. So all of those building blocks are there for you to use. Okay, so I guess a quick thing, our sort of experience of building these sorts of functions, and we're sort of in the middle of now of like this huge building craze. But this was sort of the first one that we built. And there were some interesting challenges that we had with this. So, never mind. Well, so I'll get to this stuff a bit later. So image identify, it tries to recognize any sort of image in the world. And one question is like, how do you build these sorts of functions? Because we want to obviously expose this, this function for users. And they also get the benefit of having a pre-trained network that they can use for whatever task they want to use. And we can use this in things like classify and predict as feature extractors. So building something like this is extremely useful. So one thing is you might say, okay, let's use a publicly available data set. So you might say, let's try use ImageNet. And this has, yeah, this has like 18,000 classes, but it has some problems. So first of all, it has some very strange and offensive categories for images. So for example, like this sunset is a wandering Jew, and it has one image in it of Bob Dylan, which is very strange. So this is actually the... So our first sort of idea was that we're just going to use something like ImageNet and then build on top of that. But it turned out, yeah, like there's... Okay, let's see if it loads. So this is one sort of problem, is that there's like bad categories that we don't want to have. And then there's also things like, well, once it's loaded, we'll try that. There's also completely incorrectly categorized things. So things like this image, which is, this class is defined as bobbin that passes the weft thread between the warp threads. And this is what the image actually looks like. So, and this was for shuttle. So there's all kinds of things like this. And if you train the network on this, it'll be like, yeah, this it's doing well at shuttles. So the neural network itself, it doesn't really have enough information to tell you that you've made problem that you've got mistakes or that you've got problems in your data. So basically the only solution that we could find for this sort of thing is curation. So we actually have two curation teams, one in Peru and one in India. And basically you need to have eyeballs on things like that. Like are the classes defined correctly? Maybe in the future, like if there's multiple data sets like ImageNet, I think Google released a big one as well, you could sort of try and cross-validate them in some way. Like if the network fails, train on one and it fails on certain categories and the other, that should be the same, then there might be problems. But certain things, yeah, they're very hard to automate. So, and other sort of curation tasks are very, the networks can give you a lot of information about that. Like if they get confused between two breeds of dogs, then probably the dog breeds, like the images are incorrect, or there's crossover in the data sets, or there's something like, it just needs more images. And this is one thing we noticed a lot with ImageNet, is that there's like huge amounts of gaps for certain classes of things. And overlap as well. Because you can imagine, like, any sort of semi-automated methods, it always has this issue where, you don't have experts at dog breeds who are somewhat involved in getting the classes. Because you're basically scraping it from Google or somewhere like that. And people are not very good at this sort of thing. Okay, then this is interesting as well for the neural network framework and for other parts of machine learning, which is that we have a full Bayesian optimization package. And this allows you to do hyperparameter searches. So you can define some sort of search space, and then you can say, just minimize, given the search space and the loss function, do some minimizations on that. And you can see the history of the evaluations that it's done. And it obviously has to, at every step, it needs to choose what the next best thing to try is. Evaluation history, and it also tells you what the next thing to try is. So this is the hyperparameter, or this is the hyperparameter, and this is the loss. Okay, so this is just being very summary about this, but there's many things like this, or like if you want to visualize a set of features, or all of these sorts of utility functions, in this case, I think it's TSNE, they're all built into the system. Okay, so neural networks, this is more my domain. So one question is, yeah, so there's a proliferation of neural network frameworks. Even yesterday, there was Caffe 2 was released. So there's this interesting sort of battle between all the different frameworks, and they have different advantages and disadvantages. So I wanted to just give a quick overview of our framework and sort of design decisions that went into it. So we're using this framework for all our own projects, from image classification to machine translation to speech recognition. So it's going to be very battle tested. And yeah, it obviously has CNNs, RNNs, dynamic dimensions, attention mechanisms, etc. And it's very scalable. We're using Apache MXNet as a backend, Obviously, it has full GPU support. We haven't quite hooked up multi-GPU support. And one thing that people, I'm not sure if everyone knows about this one, but this is an interesting one, that if you want to scale up NLP jobs on multiple GPUs, there's this issue that you often have very small batches per GPU, and the usage on the GPU is very low for recurrent networks. So you often have like maybe 20% usage. So I think kudaNN has recently released a framework that makes this very easy to parallelize across multiple machines. So it basically caches the neural network parameters in some GPU cache that is hard to access. But yeah, it basically allows you to scale NLP jobs to many, many GPUs very efficiently. And Baidu actually developed this technique first. Okay, and there's no lock-in, so we're very keen to have, if people want to work and play in this framework, because we believe that this framework you'll see now is probably the friendliest one to use. And we want to have that it's fun to use inside the framework, inside Mathematica, but it's also very easy to export to other frameworks. So you can already export to MXNet. We're working on a TensorFlow exporter and also on a standalone executor that you can embed in any C++ application. And this means you can train the networks and then evaluate them in some other framework, which doesn't require the massive Mathematica runtime. Okay, so the backend is MXNet. It's now the official framework of AWS. And yeah, it's a joint project of many, many companies. Actually, it's cut off on this side. Yeah, so we're also contributing to development. Okay, which has been really fun as well for us to work with MXNet team. Okay, so I guess, yeah, there's certain interesting features that MXNet has that people might not be all that familiar with. So one of them, for example, is forgetful backpropagation. So you basically are able to trade memory usage for computation. The idea is very simple. It's just that during backpropagation phase, you often you memorize the intermediate computations, but you could do an analysis and say, certain of these we're willing to forget and recompute them as we need them in the backward pass. So in the forward pass, we just throw them away. So it's slightly less efficient, but you often, for like very large recurrent networks, you're willing to make that sacrifice. And you, roughly, to give some idea of this, you can get a 90% reduction in memory usage for recurrent networks at 30% more computation time. So it allows you to train very long time sequence networks. And it kind of makes, I don't know if people know truncated backpropagation through time, but it basically makes that irrelevant, I think. And there's a bunch of papers on this from DeepMind and from the MXNet people. And then it also has some interesting design ideas. So for example, it tries to merge imperative and declarative frameworks. So imperatives like PyTorch, where you don't construct a graph at the beginning of of training. It does that like on the fly. So there's examples of this like MinPy, which are built on MXNet that allow you to do both. And yeah, it also has some interesting things that for people that design frameworks are interesting, like all the graph optimization stuff. So once you once you create the graph, the computation graph, there's a backend called NNVM, which is like the analog of LLVM for compilers, and it tries to do as many optimizations as it can on that graph before it does training. Okay, so it's an interesting framework. It's one of the most scalable ones, which is why AWS chose it. This is a graph actually from Chainer. So they show that like MXNet and Chainer are basically have the best scaling to many GPUs. So that's also another important thing for us. Like we want to do industrial scale training, and it needs to be able to scale. Okay, so enough about the backends. I want to show you quickly what this actually looks like to use. So we have, first of all, we have models built into the language. And these ones get downloaded from a resource repository. So for example, like Image Identify that I showed you earlier, you can get the network from there via NetModel. And this is what the network looks like. And each of these things, you can see a few interesting things. So one is you can click on any node, and it will give you the information of this node. In this case, this is a chain. You can see NetChain. But there's also these graphs. And this netchain is just, yeah, it has, I mean, this is like, a, I think, inception of version something. And you can actually look at the graphs as well and see exactly what, yeah, what these guys are. And you can even click on the graphs and see more information. So this is a very nice sort of interface for seeing things. So, and also, yeah, obviously you can see that there's nice shape information. Then, the interesting thing then is that one difference that we have from other frameworks is that we decided that neural networks need pieces on the end and the beginning that come with the network that we call encoders and decoders. So if you saw this thing, it says there's an image coming in. So there's something, yeah, there's these functions called NetEncoder, which basically encodes an image. Like you can give it a mean image, you can give it what color space you want to encode it to, and it basically just makes sure that it's a tensor when it comes out. And the same with decoders. You often get probability vectors out of the network, but you almost always don't want the probability vectors. You want classes of things. So what this allows us to do is that you can apply the network directly to an image. So in this case, it's a lake, and it returns that this concept is a lake. So you can also obviously ask the same as classify and predict, because everything in the language is like built together. You can ask also like what are the top probabilities, or if you really wanted to, you can get the whole probability set. So this is very simple, and what's nice about this is that when you're exporting these models, they come with everything included. Like if you have a cafe model, there's all kinds of metadata floating around, like the mean image, like the classes, like all of this sort of stuff, and what color space they were using, BGR in the case of cafe. What's this thing? You just have everything is built in. In the same, we have encoders for images and also for text. So that's the first thing. It's also very easy to do surgery on the network. So take is a system function for, like if you take 1, 2, 3, and I'm going to take the first two elements, I can do that. 1, 2. And the same sort of thing applies to networks. And -3, obviously, same, oops. So -2, obviously, index from the end. That's the whole set. So this guy, you can do the same thing. You just take the network, and bam, you get another network out. And this obviously for like feature extraction, this is what you often want to do. Just cut off the last few layers. Or if you want to extract sub-pieces, like these graphs. So basically, there's two types. There's a graph and there's a chain. So these are containers. Like in Torch, I guess you see them as containers. And each of these is a valid layer in themselves. So if you make a chain, this is now a perfectly valid layer that can be fed into other chains or other graphs or whatever else. And you can obviously, yeah, you can say the network, give me the 10th element in this list. In this case, it's an element-wise layer, or 22. Okay, so that's how simple that is. Also, what's cool, what we've added, is that, which we think is going to be popular at some point, is construction notebooks. So you often have a situation for neural networks where you have a model definition, like a cafe parameter file, but you don't really know what produced it. So when you're defining something at top level, like in cafe, or you might have a Python definition, TensorFlow, then you want to know how to actually construct these from, you know, from the actual, like if you had to start from scratch. So we have a construction notebook, which gives you things like the parameter settings, how to construct the final network. Actually, let's run this. And bam, there we go. We have a network. And this red just means that the parameters haven't been initialized yet. Okay, so, and there's a bunch of other metadata you can get with NetModel. So things like, obviously, the source of the network and all this sort of thing. And the other thing that we're busy building, which unfortunately was not ready for for today, which I was hoping it would be, obviously. Okay, this doesn't look very clean. No, that's not, okay, you can't see that. Okay, but basically there's a neural network repository that will have all these networks. So there's a website, and the same thing as a resource system. Okay, so basically one of the things that we can do as a company is we can spend a lot of developer time converting models. This is like one of those unglamorous tasks that people that people don't often want to do in the open source world, because it's just a mess. All the frameworks have different conventions, lots of them have post-processing code or pre-processing code. Like if you're doing semantic segmentation, they often have post-processing code that is in Python, and then they've got the model, and it's just very complicated to actually convert it to a different framework. So this is one thing that we're working on very heavily. So there's maybe in the region of 30 to 40 models that we're trying to put into this repository from Caffe, Torch, TensorFlow, MXNet, Darknet, etc. So that's the first thing. Then the second thing is that we're trying to train lots of these networks. So we have roughly 30 different top-level functions that we want to train with neural networks. So from language translate to speech to text. And each of these will be available in the neural network repository. So for some of these, like speech to text, there's very few companies that actually release their models. So things like Baidu have Deep Speech 2, but you're never going to be able to get your hands on the actual neural network. And these networks are super useful for users. Like this is an extremely powerful feature extractor for spoken audio. So the sort of workflow that we use for building these things, so let's see what the time is quickly. So do you have a time somewhere?
It's 5 to 4.
Can you start it? Okay. I'll wrap quickly now. Okay, fine. I won't go into that too much. I'll just quickly jump across a few of these things. So training networks is very simple. You can have layers or you can have containers, and it'll just train it, and you can evaluate it on some data. You can also visualize things quite nicely. So for example, here's a data set of a function, and the task is going to be to predict the function. So just a regression problem. So we do a simple two-layer multi-layer perceptron, which is this guy here, or three layers, sorry. And then we can train it. And during the training, we can actually visualize how it's fitting this function. And there's a whole bunch of these sorts of visualization things you can do, from visualizing what the gradients are looking like to all sorts of things that help you debug when there's problems. And you can obviously plot the last solution. Okay, so one of the major features that we've added is dynamic dimensions. So many frameworks don't actually have very good support for this, where they require you to pad things. So if you have examples of different length, you basically have to pad them to be the right size. So we've decided that we really need to handle this properly, and we're working towards handling it for all different dimensions, but for now, it's the first dimension, the sequence dimension. So you can have an LSTM layer, a softmax, and you can tell it that it's varying, the first dimension. So you can see N, it just says it's not known. And then to train this efficiently, there's a lot of sort of grunt work that is required from the part of the user usually. So you want to group examples with similar lengths together, and then bucketing, where you want to choose execution graphs of different lengths that share the same parameters. So as an example of this, what we actually do in the back end is, this is MX plan plot, so if you have the network, you can unroll it so for certain lengths, and you can see what the MXNet sort of thing looks like. Or if I unroll it, if the sequence was length 4, it'll look a lot more complicated. So basically, like MXNet, for example, like you'd have to deal with this yourself. It's up to the user to bucket, it's up to the user to create the multiple executors, and we sort of automate this entire process very nicely for people. So as a random example, if you want to do sorting some numbers, so as an example of this, here's a list of numbers, unsorted to sorted, simple task. And they come in different lengths. So some of them are length 6, some of them are length 2. So we need to have variable length sequences for this. So we can have a graph. This is a simple network with a tension layer, which improves the performance quite a lot for this sort of task. This is what the network looks like. Pretty simple to construct, and then it's simple to train as well. Uh, This is not, yeah, this aspect ratio looks very bad in my, with this projector. Okay, so you can, normally, I mean, this should be much bigger.
Excuse me, yeah? Is object cube distributed across these GPUs or servers of GPUs?
So we're actually in the middle of adding multi-GPU support. So it doesn't quite, right now it doesn't do that. But very, very soon it will. Okay, so yeah, you've trained for a bit, and then you can try it on some example. Okay, this was not a good example. I didn't train it for very long. Oopsie. Okay, this is not sorting it properly. Okay, that sorted it. Okay, so this is like a simple example of a sorting network. And you can see in this, the shapes that these are arbitrary lengths. And also what's cool is you can have multiple different, so like if there's two sequences that come in, that handles it properly as well. So things like sequence-to-sequence learning, perfectly fine. Okay, I guess I won't go into too much into this, but basically we spent a lot of time writing a shape and type inferencer. Maybe I'll just show that, for example, like embedding layer, if you look at the information, it will give you nice English descriptions as well, like tensor of integers between 1 and 3. And if I try something that's wrong, it'll give me a very friendly message, expected vector of indices between 1 and 3. So this took us a lot of work to get this to work nicely. I guess the time is mostly up. So there's also, we've got operators like nest and fold. So for example, you can define your own recurrent networks as a fold operation. So you just define a single time step network, and then you say net fold it. And this now is defined, this is the same as just an ordinary RNN. You can define GRUs, whatever you want. And this obviously works for variable length sequences as well. And net map operator allows you to, just map things across. And this is a very powerful form of weight sharing as well. Okay, I think that's it. So, does anyone have any questions?
So I'm curious, a quick show of hands, who knew that all existed? Yeah, neither did I. so good. So questions for Sebastian.
This is a difficult question, but you see, there's still so much development around frameworks, paradigms are still being worked out. Now PyTorch is the latest thing that people want to use. How are you planning to keep up with all of this? Like on a planning level, you have a team that just reads the latest iClear papers and tries to do the equivalent Wolfram language version of it, or how do you go about this?
That's a good question. So yeah, so I mean, there's so much flux with the frameworks. I guess the main thing is we have reviews of all the frameworks. So as soon as a new framework comes out, we need to understand exactly how it works and what advantages it has. So like PyTorch has things that we can't do right now. And we have plans for introducing functionality like PyTorch, because it is like it's a paradigm that we can't see. So basically, we ask the question to ourselves, do we think that this paradigm will be there to stay, or is this something that is sort of faddish? And for certain things, like PyTorch having an imperative framework, we can't see how that can be faddish. Like, that seems very powerful. So we want to support that. But other kinds of things, we might be more skeptical about. Like the latest, there's always new recurrent layers that come out, for example. Like there's almost always, the latest, greatest one. And we tend to take a skeptical view of those.
So what interests me is, as a company doing it internally, you've invested a lot in data curation, and I think Wolfram Alpha was a big driver for that.
Correct.
And now what's really interesting here is you're investing a lot in, I'd say, model curation, which is something that people perhaps haven't really even started thinking about. Is this a pull or a push thing for you? Is it customers pushing you to do this, saying we want this, or is it you saying, hey, our customers are going to want this, let's get it there?
It's definitely a combination. So we've had customers that have put a lot of pressure on us to get the latest models out. Yeah. So in terms of model creation, that's the main thing. But I guess this framework itself is like, there's a whole bunch of company projects, including Wolfram Alpha stuff, that wants to use neural networks, and it's a nice thing that we can support both customers and then also internal use.
And how are you handling licensing issues around these models? So if you create a model from ImageNet, then or a customer creates it partially from these sort of things, then who ends up owning the model and etc.?
That's a dangerous question, especially with with cameras.
So it's unclear, I guess.
Well, okay. I don't know how much I can say about this, but we've obviously done a lot of legal homework. But again, I can't say what the result of those legal discussions were. There seems to be a view in the community, let's put it this way, that derived works from data sets are not licensed according to that data set. This has not been put to trial yet. So there's not been a single test case in the courts. So this is speculation. But things like you've seen CAFE, for example, like with their ImageNet models, they've now decided that there should be, I think, Apache 2 or something. So they've made it completely, they've broken it from the license of the data set. Google has decided the same thing.
But if you're offering all this expert functionality, mm-hmm. or the APIs, the web APIs, so do you expect any licensing to come out of that or not?
So from the data sets, maybe not. But we can't definitively say. But there's obviously, yeah.
So if I use your API to build a commercial product,
sure.
Do I have to pay you more than my personal Wolfram license to use that API on
no.
the web? Good.
Yeah, it comes with a product.
So and you can export that net as well to any other framework.
It's what's right.
You can export that net. Aldo can export the net he's trained as well.
Yeah. So if you have that, then you can use it in other frameworks. And it's not like MATLAB where you have lots of packages which have to be bought separately. So if you buy Mathematica, you get everything. It's the full deal.
Other questions? If we could just thank Sebastian again for a great talk.